I learn in this letter that Don Pedro of Aragon comes this night to Messina.
He is very near by this. He was not 3 leagues off when I left him.
How many gentlemen have you lost in this action?
50 of any sort, none of name.
A victory is twice itself when the achiever brings home full numbers. I learn here that Don Pedro hath bestowed much honor on a young Florentine called Claudio.
Much deserved on his part, and equally remembered by Don Pedro. He hath borne himself beyond the promise of his age, doing in the figure of a lamb, the feats of a lion. He hath indeed bettered expectation than what you must expect him to tell you how.
I pray you, has Signor Montanto returned from the wars or no?
I know none of that name, lady. There was none in the army of any sort.
What is he that you ask for, niece?
My cousin means Signor Benedict, the Padua.
Oh, he's returned, and as pleasant as ever he was.
I pray you, how many hath he killed and eaten in these wars? But how many hath he killed? For indeed I promised to eat all of his killing.
Faith, niece, you tax Signor Benedict too much. But he'll be meet with you, I doubt it not.
He hath done good service, lady, in these wars.
You had musty victual, and he hath the hope to eat it. He is a very valiant trencherman. He has an excellent stomach.
And a good soldier too, lady.
And a good soldier too, a lady. But what is he to a lord?
A lord to a lord, a man to a man, stuffed with all honorable virtues.
It is so indeed. He is no less than a stuffed man. But for the stuffing, well, we are all mortal.
You must not mistake my niece. There's a merry war betwixt Signor Benedict and her. They never meet, but there's a skirmish of wit between them.
Alas, he gets nothing by that. In our last conflict, 4 of his 5 wits went halting off, and now is a whole man governed with one. So that if he have wit enough to keep himself warm, let him bear the difference between himself and his horse. For it is all the wealth he have left in the world to be known a reasonable creature. I pray you, who is his companion now? He hath every month a new sworn brother.
Is possible?
Very easily possible. He wears his faith, but at the fashion of his hat, it ever changes with the next cloth.
I see, lady. The gentleman is not in your books.
No, if he were, I would burn my study. But I pray you, who is his companion?
He is most in the company of the right noble, Claudio.
Oh, Lord. He will hang upon him like a disease. It is sooner caught in the pestilence, and the taker runs presently mad. If Claudio hath caught the Benedict, it will cost him £1,000 ere I be cured.
I will hold friends with you, lady.
You, good friend.
You will never run mad, niece.
No, not till a hot January.
Don Pedro's approach!
Good Signor Leonardo, are you come to meet your trouble? The fashion of the world is to avoid cost since you encounter it.
Never came trouble to my house in the likeness of your grace. For trouble being gone, comfort, sugar maid. But when you depart from me, sorrow abides, and happiness takes his leave.
You embrace your charge too willingly. I think this is your daughter.
Her mother hath many times told me so.
Were you in doubt, sir, that you asked her?
Signor Benedict, no. For were you a child?
You have it full, Benedict. Be happy, lady, for you were like an honorable father.
If Signor Leonardo be a father, she would not have his head on her shoulders.
I wonder that you will still be talking, Signor Benedict. Nobody marks you.
What?
My dear Lady Disdain, are you living?
Is it possible Disdain should die when she hath such meat food to feed it as Signor Benedict? Courtesy itself must convert to Disdain if she is to come into your presence.
Then is courtesy a turncoat? But it is certain I am loved of all ladies. You accept it. And I would I could find in my heart that I had not a hard heart, for truly I love none.
But dear happiness to women, they would else have been troubled by a pernicious suitor. I thank God and my cold blood that I am of your humor for that. I had rather hear my dog bark at a crow than a man swear he loves me.
God, keep your ladyship still in that mind. Some gentleman or other shall scape a predestinate scratch face.
Scratching could not make it worse than for such a face as yours were.
Well, you are a rare parrot, teacher.
A bird of my tongue is better than a beast of yours.
I would my horse had the speed of your tongue, and so good a continue. But keep your way. In God's name, I have done.
You always end with a jade's trick. I know you of old.
That is the sum of all, Leonardo. Claudio and Benedict, my dear friend hath invited you all. I tell him we shall stay at the least a month, but he heartily prays for the occasion may detain us longer.
Let me bid you welcome, your highness. being reconciled to the prince, your brother. I owe you all duty.
Thank you. I am not of many words, but I thank you.
Please, it, your grace, lead on.
Your hand, Leonardo. We will go together. Benedict! Didst thou note the daughter of Leonardo?
I noted her not, but I looked on her.
Is she not a modest young lady?
Question me as an honest man should do, for my simple, true judgment. Or would you have me speak after my custom as being a professed tyrant to your sex?
No, I pray you, speak in sober judgment.
Why, the faith may think she's too low for a high praise, and too little for a great praise. Only this commendation I can afford her, that were she other than she is, she were unhandsome. And being no other but as she is, I do not like her.
Nothing to say in jest. Pray me, truly, tell me how thou likest her.
Would you buy her that you inquire after her?
Can the world buy such a jewel?
Yea, in a case to put it into.
In my eye, she was the prettiest lady I have ever seen.
I can see yet without spectacles, and I see no such matter. There's her cousin, but she weren't possessed with the fury. Exceeds her as much as beauty as the 1st of May that the last of December. I hope you have no intent to turn husband. Have you?
I would scarce trust myself, though I had sworn the contrary if Hero would be my wife.
It's come to this! Hath not the world one man but will wear his cap with suspicion? Shall I never see a bachelor of 21 again?
What secret hath held you here that you followed not to the Leonardos?
I would your grace would constrain me to tell.
I charge thee on thy legions.
You hear, Count Claudio? I could be secret as a dumb man. I would have you think so, but on my legions, mark you this. On my legions, he is in love.
With who? Hero,
Leonardo's short daughter.
Amen, if you love her, for the lady is very well worthy. Thou speakest this to fetch me in, my lord. By my troth, I speak my thoughts. And in truth, lord, I spoke mine.
By my true faith, in troth, my lord, I spoke mine.
That I love her, I feel.
That she is worthy, I know.
That I neither know how she should be loved, nor know how she should be worthy, is the opinion that fire can melt out of me, and I'll die at the stake. That a woman could see me, I thank her. That she brought me up, I give her the most humble thanks. But I will do myself right to trust none. And the fine is, in which I may go the finer, I'll live a bachelor.
I shall see, ere I die, look pale with love.
With anger, with sickness, or with hunger, my lord, not with love.
Hath Leonato any son, my lord?
None but Hero, she is his only heir. Dost thou affect her?
Oh, my lord, when you went forward on this ended action, I looked on her with a soldier's eye, that liked but had a different task in hand. But now I am returned, and those war thoughts are vacant, and in their places are thronging tones, all prompting me how fair young Hero is.
Thou wilt be like a lover present, entire the hearer with a book of words. If thou dost love Hero, cherish it. I know we shall have a reveling tonight. I will assume thy part in some disguise, and tell fair Hero I am Claudio, and in her bosom I'll unclasp my heart, and the conclusion is, she shall be thine. Come, let us put it into practice.
How now, sister?
Brother, I have strange news that you yet dreamt not of. The prince and Count Claudio, while walking in a thick-leashed alley in my orchard, were thus much overheard by a man of mine. The prince discovered to Count Claudio that he was in love with my niece, your daughter, and he meant to acknowledge it this night in the dance, and if he found her important, he meant to take the present time by the top and instantly break with you with it.
Hath the fellow any wit that told you this?
Good, sharp fellow. I will send for him and question him yourself.
No, no. We will hold it as a dream until it appear itself.
but I will acquaint my daughter with all that she may be better prepared for an answer. Peradventure this be true. Go now and tell her of it.
Your Highness, why are you thus out of measure sad?
There's no measure for the occasion that breeds, therefore the sadness is without limit.
You should hear reason.
When I have heard it, what blessings bring it?
If not a present remedy, at least a patient sufferance.
I wonder that thou, being as thou sayest thou art born under Saturn, goes about to apply a mortal medicine to a mortifying mischief. I cannot hide what I am. I must be sad when I have a cause and laugh at no man's jest, eat when I have stomach and tend on no man in leisure, sleep when I am drowsy and wait on no man in his business, laugh when I am merry and claw at no man in his humor.
Yea, but you must not make the full show of this until you may do so without controlment. You have of late stood out against your brother, and he hath tinned you newly into his grace, where it is impossible you should take true root, but by the fair weather you make yourself. It is needful that you frame the season for your own harvest.
I'd rather be a canker in a hedge than a rose in his grace, and it better fits my blood to be disdained of all than to fashion a carriage to rob love of any. It cannot be said that I am a flattering, honest woman. It cannot be denied that I am a plain-dealing villain. I've been entrusted with a muzzle and enfranchised with a clog. Therefore, I decree not to sing in my cage. If I had my mouth, I would fight. If I had my liberty, I'd do my liking. In the meantime, let me be what I am. Seek not to alter me.
You make no use of your discontent.
I make all use for it, for I use it. Who comes here? What news, Baraccio?
I came yonder from the great supper. The prince, your brother, is royally entertained by Leonato, and I give you intelligence of an intended marriage.
Will it serve any model to build mischief on?
Mary, it's your brother's right hand.
Who? The most exquisite Claudio?
Even he.
A proper squire. And who, which way looks he?
Mary, on hero, the daughter and heir of Renata.
A very forward march chick. How came you to this?
Being entertained for a perfumer, I heard it agreed upon at the Prince of Wounded Hero on behalf of Count Claudio.
Come, let us thither. This may prove food for my displeasure. The young startup hath all the glory for his overthrow. If I could cross him in any way, I'd be blessed in every way. You both are sure who will assist me?
To the death, Your Highness.
Come, let us do the great banquet. Shall we go prove on what's to be done?
We'll wait upon Your Excellency.
Was not Doña Joan here at supper?
I saw her not. How acidly that lady looks. I can never see her if I am harboring now for hours.
Oh, she is of a very melancholy disposition.
For she an excellent man made just in the midway between her and Benedick. One is too like an image and says nothing. The other is too like my lady's eldest son, evermore tattling.
Then hath Signor Benedick's tongue in Donna Jones' mouth, and hath Donna Jones' melancholy in Signor Benedick's face.
With a good leg and a good foot, uncle, and money enough in his purse, such a man could win any woman in the world, if I could get her goodwill.
By my troth, niece, thou wilt never get thee a husband, being so shrewd of thy tongue.
In faith, she's too cursed.
Just, if God send me no husband, for the which blessing I am at him on my knees every morning and evening. Lord, I could not endure a husband with a beard on his face. I had rather lie in the womb.
You may delight in a husband that hath no beard.
He that hath no beard is less than a man, and he that hath a beard is more than a youth. And he that is less than a man, I am not for him, and he that is more than a youth, he is not for me. Therefore, I will take sixpence in earnest of the bare ward and leave his apes in the house.
Well, I hope to see you one day fitted with a husband.
Not until God make men of some other metal than earth. Adam's sons are my brethren, and truly I hold it a sin to match in his kindred.
Daughter, remember what I told you. If the prince doth solicit you in that kind, you know your answer.
The fault will be in the music, cousin, if not be wooed in good time. If the prince be too important, tell him there is measure in everything, and so dance out your answer.
Niece, you apprehend passing shrewdly.
I have a good eye, uncle. I can see a church by daylight.
The rebels are entering now. Make your way.
Claudio, I know him by his bearing.
Are you not Signor Benedict?
You know me well. I am he.
Signor, you are very near to my brother and his love. He is enamored on Hero. I pray you dissuade him from her, for she is no equal in his birth. You may do the part of an honest man in it.
May this be so?
I heard him swear his affection.
I did too. He swore he would marry her tonight.
Come, let us to the supper.
Tis certain so, the prince woos for himself. Friendship is constant in all things, save in the offices and affairs of love. For beauty is a witch, against whose charms faith melteth into blood. This is an accident of hourly proof, which I mistrusted not. Farewell, therefore, hero.
Claudio, will you go with me?
Whither?
Give it to the next will. It's about your own business, Count. Come for the prince, I've got your hero.
I wish him joy of her.
Why, that spoke like an honest drover, so they sell bullets. But did you think the prince served you thus?
If it will not be, then I will leave you.
Alas, poor heart foul. Now will he creep into sedges. That my lady Beatrice should know me, and not know me. The prince's fool. It may be I go under that title because I am married. But so I am apt to dupe myself wrong? I'm not so reputed. It is the base nobility of Beatrice that puts the world into her person and so gives me out. Well, I'll be revenged as I may.
Now, Benedict, where's Claudio? Did you see him?
Troth, my lord, I told him, and I think I told him true, that your grace will get the goodwill of this young lady. Tis a flat transgression of a schoolboy who, being overjoyed at finding a bird's nest, shows it to his companion, and he steals it.
I will but teach them to sing and restore them to their owner.
If their singing answers your saying, my lord, by my faith, you speak honestly.
The Lady Beatrice had the quarrel with you. The gentleman that danced with her told her she is much wronged by you.
Oh, she misused me past the endurance of a block. An oak with one green leaf would have answered her. My very visor began to assume life and scold with her. She told me, not think I'd been myself, that I was the prince's jester.
Oh.
She speaks poniards, and every word stabs
you.
I would not marry her, though she endowed with all of them Adam had left before he transgressed. Come. I would to God some scholar would conjure her, for certainly, while she is here, a man may live as quiet in hell as in a sanctuary. And people sin upon purpose because they go thither. So indeed all disquiet, horror, and perturbation follows her.
Look, here she comes.
Would your grace command me any service to the world's head? I'm not going the slightest hand not to be intimidated that you could advise to send me off. I'll fetch you two foot now from the furthest inch of Asia. Do any message to the pigs? Rather, they hold a three words conference with this harpy. You have no employment for me?
None but to desire your good company.
Oh, here's a dish I love not. I cannot endure my lady tongue.
Come, lady, you have lost the hearts of Signor Benedict.
He lent it me a while, and I gave him use for it. A double heart for his single one. Mary, once before, he wanted of me with false dice. So your grace may well say I have lost it.
You have put him down, lady. You have put him down.
So I would not he should do me, my lord, lest I should prove the mother of fools. I have brought Count Claudio, whom you sent me to seek.
Why, how now, Count? Wherefore are you sad?
Not sad, my lord.
Claudio is sick.
Not sick, my lord.
The count is neither sad, nor sick, nor merry, nor well, but civil, count. Civil as an orange, and that of a jealous confection.
Faith, I think your blazon to be true, though if this be so, his conceit is false. Here, Claudio, I wooed in thy name, and fair hero is won. Name the day of marriage, and God give thee joy.
Speak, count, 'tis your cue.
Silence is the perfectest herald of joy. I were but little happy if I could say so much. Lady, as you are mine, I am yours. I give myself willingly and dote upon the exchange.
Speak, cousin, and if you cannot, stop his mouth with a kiss so that he shall speak neither.
In faith, lady, you have a merry.
Yea, it keeps on the windy side of care. She tells him in his ear that he is in her heart.
And so she doth, cousin.
Good Lord for alliance, and thus goes everyone into the world but I. And I am sunburnt. I may sit in a corner and cry, hey ho, for a husband.
Lady Beatrice, will you have me, lady?
No, my lord, lest I should have another for working days. Your grace is too costly to wear every day. But I beseech you, I was born to speak all mirth and no matter.
Your silence most offends me. And to be merry best becomes you, for out of question, you were born in a merry hour.
No, sure, my lord. My mother cried, but then a star danced, and under her I was born.
Niece, did you look to those things that I told you of?
I cry you mercy, uncle. By your grace's pardon.
By my troth, pleasant-spirited lady.
There's little of the melancholy element in her, sir. She's never sad but for when she sleeps, and not ever sad then. For I've heard my daughter say that she has often dreamt of unhappiness and waked herself with laughing.
She cannot endure to hear tell of a husband.
Oh, by no means. She mocks all her wooers out of suit.
She were an excellent wife for Benedict.
Oh, my lord, if they were but a week married, they would talk themselves mad.
Claudio, when mean you to go to church?
Tomorrow, my lord. Time runs on crutches till love hath all his rights.
Not till Monday, my dear son, which is hence just a seven-night.
Come, Claudio. Time shall not cajole by us. I will, in the interim, undertake one of Hercules' labors, which is to bring Benedict and Beatrice into a mountain of affection with one the other. I would fain have it a match, and I doubt not but to fashion it, if you three will both minister such assistance as I will give you direction.
My lord, I implore you, though it cost me a 10 nights watchings.
And I, my lord.
And you too, gentle hero.
I will do any modest office, my lord, to help my cousin to a good husband.
And Benedict is not the unhopefulest husband that I know. I, with your two helps, will so practice on them that, in despite of their quick wit and queasy stomach, they will fall in love with one another. If we do this, Cupid is no longer an archer. His glory shall be ours, for we are the only love gods. Go on in, and I will tell you my drift.
Margaret, turn to me, Claudio, to hear me call Margaret Hero. Bring him this night for the intended wedding, or I will so fashion the matter that hero shall be absent. And there, such seeming truth shall be called. Such seeming truth that hero's disloyalty, that jealousy shall be called. Assurance, and all the preparation be overthrown.
Throw to this what adverse issue it can. I will put it in practice. Be kind in working this, and thy fee is 1,000 ducats. I will go presently learn their day of marriage.
I do much wonder that one man, see how much another man is a fool, when he dedicates his behaviors to love, will, hath yet laughed at such shallow follies in others, become the argument of his own scorn by falling in love with such a name as Claudio. May I be converted and see with these eyes? Who can I tell? I think not. I will not be sworn, but love may transform me to an oyster. But I'll take my oath on it. Till he have made an oyster me, he shall never make me such a fool. The prince and senor love. I will hide me in the arbor.
Yea, my lord, all how still the day is, has hushed on purpose to grace harmony.
I see you where Benedict hath hid himself.
Very well, my lord.
Come, Balthazar, let us hear that song again.
No good, my lord. Tax not so bad a voice as to slander music any more than once.
It is the witness still of excellency to put a strange face on his own perfection. I pray thee sing and let me woo no more.
Because you talk of wooing, I will sing. Sigh no more, lady, sigh no more. Men were deceivers ever, one foot in sea and one on shore, to one thing constant never. Then sigh not so, but let them go. Sounds of woe into hay, nonny, nonny. Sing no more, ditty, sing no more of dumps so dull and heavy. The fraud of men was ever so since summer first was leaving. Sigh not so, and let them go, and be you blithe and bonny, converting all your sounds of woe into a nonny, nonny.
By troth, a good song.
And an ill singer, my lord.
Ah, no, no, Faith. Thou singest well. I pray thee, get us some excellent music for tomorrow night.
The best I can, my lord.
Do so. Farewell. Come hither, Leonardo. What was it you told me of today? That your niece Beatrice was in love with Benedict.
Away, stock on, the foul sits. 'Tis certain so, I did never think that lady would love any man.
No, nor I neither, but most wonderful that she should so dote on Signor Benedict, whom she hath in all outward behaviors seemed ever to abhor.
It's possible?
By my troth, my lord, I do not know what to think of it, but that she loves him with an enraged affection.
Maybe she doth but counterfeit.
Oh, faith, like enough.
Oh, God, counterfeit? There was never counterfeit of passion. Came so near the life of passion as she discovers it.
What effects of passion shows she?
What effects, my lord?
Bait the hook well, this fish will bite.
You amaze me. I would have thought her spirit had been invincible against all assaults of affection.
As would I, especially against Benedict.
I should think this is a goal, but that Leonardo speaks it. Nathan cannot sure hide himself in such reverence.
Yet they in the infection hold it up.
Hath she made her affection known to Benedict?
No, and swears she never will. That's her torment.
'Tis true, your daughter tells us. Shall I, says she, have so oft spoke to him with scorn, write to him that I love him?
This as she begins to write to him, for she will be up 20 times a night, and there she will sit in her smock till she has writ a sheet of paper. My daughter tells us all.
It were good that Benedict knew of it by some other, if she will not discover it.
To what end, my lord? He would make but a sport of it, and mock her worse.
She is an excellent sweet lady, and out of all suspicion, she is virtuous.
And exceeding wise.
In everything but in loving Benedict.
My lord, wisdom and blood combating in so tender a body. We have 10 proofs to 1. That blood hath the victory. But I am sorry for her, as I have just cause being her uncle and her guardian.
I would she bestow this dotage on me. I would have deft all respects and made her half myself. I pray thee, tell Benedict of it, and hear what he will say.
Think it good, were you?
Hero thinks she will die.
Die? Oh, shit.
For she says she will die, if he love her not, and she will die ere she make her love known, and she will die ere he woo her, rather than she wait one breath of her accustomed crossness.
She doth well if she should make tender of her love. 'Tis very possible he'll scorn it, for the man is, you know all, that the contemptible spirit.
He is a very proper man.
He hath indeed a good outward happiness.
Before God, and in my mind, very wise.
He doth indeed show some sparks that are like wit. Leonardo, I am sorry for your niece. Shall we go seek Benedict and tell him of her love?
Never tell him, my lord. Rather, let her wear it out in good counsel.
Nay, that may be impossible.
She may wear her heart out first.
Well, we will hear further of it from your daughter.
Your Grace, will you walk? Dinner is ready.
If you do not dote on her upon this, I will never trust my expectation.
Let us send her to Colum to dinner.
Trick! They have the truth of this Raniero. They seem to pity the lady. It seems her affections have the full bet. Love! Me? Why, it must be requited.
I hear how I am censured.
They say I will bear myself proudly if I perceive the love come from her. They say, too, she'd rather die than give any sign of affection. I do never need to marry.
I must not seem proud. Happy are they, happy to hear their detractions and put them to mending.
They say the lady is fair. 'Tis the truth.
I could bear them witness and virtuous, tis so.
Well, I cannot reprove it in wise for loving me on my troth.
It is no addition to her wit, nor no great argument of her folly, that I will come horribly in love with her. I may chance have some odd works and remnants of wit broken in me.
What?
Doth not the appetite alter? A man loves meat in his youth that he cannot endure in his age. Shall quips and sentences and these paper bullets in the brain awe a man for the career of his humor? No! The world must be peopled. When I said I'd die a bachelor, I did not think I'd live till I were married.
Here comes Peaches.
Fine.
Day.
She is a fair lady. I do spot some much love in her.
Against my will, I am sent to bid thee come into dinner.
Fair Beatrice, I thank you for your pains.
I took no more pains in those thanks than you take pains to thank me. If it had been painful, I would not have come.
You take pleasure then in the message?
Yea, as one might take a knife's point and choke a doll withal. You have no stomach, senor. Fare you well.
Against my will, I am sent to bid you come into dinner. There's a double meaning in that. I'm in love. I'm in love. I'm in love.
But who dare tell her so? If I should speak, she would mock me into air.
She would laugh me out of myself, press me to death with wit. Therefore, let Benedick, like covered fire, consume away in thighs, waste inwardly, that were a better death than die with mocks, which is as bad as die with tickling.
Well, yet, tell her of it, hear what she will say.
No, no. Rather, I will go to Benedick and counsel him to fight against his passions and truly all device and honest slander to sustain my cousin with. For one doth not know how much the ill word may employ in lightning.
Oh, do not do your cousin such a wrong. She cannot be so much without your judgment, having so swift and excellent a wit, as she is prized to have, as to refuse so rare a gentleman as Signor Benedick.
Oh, he is the only man of Italy, always excepting my dear Claudio.
I pray you, be not angry with me, madam. Speaking my fancy, Signor Benedick, for shape, for bearing, argument, and valor, goes foremost to report through Italy.
Indeed, he hath an excellent good name.
His excellence did earn it, ere he had it. When are you married, madam?
Why, every day tomorrow. Come, go in, I'll show thee some attires, and have thy counsel, which is the best to furnish me in tomorrow.
She's blind, I warrant you, we have caught her, madam.
If it proves so, then loving goes by halves. Some cupids kill with arrows, but some with traps.
What fire is in mine ears? Stand I condemned for crying and scorn so much? Contempt, farewell, and maiden pride, adieu. No glory lives behind the backs of such. And Benedick, love on. I will requite thee, taming my wild heart to thy loving hand. If thou dost love, my kindness shall incite thee to bind our loves up in a holy band. For others say thou dost deserve, and I believe it better than reporting thee.
Gallants, I am not as I have been.
So say I. Methinks you are sadder.
I hope we be in love. Hang him, true what? There's no true drop of blood in him to be truly touched with love. If he be sad, he wants money.
I have the toothache.
Draw it.
Hang it.
You must hang it first, then draw it after. This just is confirmed he is in love.
This is no charm for the toothache. Leonardo, walk aside with me. I have gates or nine wise words to speak to you about,
which these hobby horses must not hear. To break with him about the interest.
'Tis certain so. By this, Hero and Ursula have played their part, and now the two bears will not fight one another when they meet.
My lord and brother, God save you.
Good day, sister.
I would speak with you.
In private.
If that would please you, yet how Claudio may hear for what I speak of concerns him.
Very well.
Means your lordship to be married tomorrow?
You know he does.
I know not that, since he knows what I know.
If there be any impediment, I pray you, discover it.
You may think I love you not. Let that appear hereafter, and aim better at me now that I will manifest.
Very well.
I came hither to tell you. The lady is disloyal.
No. Hero?
Your hero, Leonardo's hero, everyone's hero?
Spoil.
Word is too good to paint out her wickedness. I could say she were worse, but come with me tonight, bring the prince, my brother, and see her chamber window entered, even the night before her wedding day. If you loved her then, tomorrow wed her, but it may better fit your honor to change your mind.
May this be so?
If you believe not what you see, confess not that you know. If you follow me, you will see soon enough. I will disparage her no farther till you both are my witnesses. Well, then bear it coldly till midnight and let the issue show itself.
you good citizens and true?
Yea, or else it were pity, but they should suffer salvation, body and soul.
Nay, that were a punishment too good for them, should they have any allegiance in them, being chosen for the prince's watch! First, who think you here the most desertless one to be constable? Come hither, neighbor Sequoia. God hath blessed you with a good name. To be a well-favored one is the gift of fortune, but to write and read comes by nature.
Both. Which, Master Constable?
You have! I knew it would be your answer. Well, for your favor, man, why give God thanks and make no boast of it? For your writing and reading, let that appear when there is no need of such vanity. Well, you were thought here to be the most senseless and fit one for constable. Therefore, bear you the lantern. This is your charge. You are to comprehend all fragrant men. You are to bid any man stand in the prince's name.
But how if he will not stand?
Why, then take no note of him, but let him go, and presently call forth the rest of the watch together, and thank God you are rid of a knave.
And if he will not stand when he is bidden, he is none of the prince's subjects.
True, and they are to meddle with none but the prince's subjects. You will also make no noise in the streets, for the watch to talk and to babble is most tolerable and not to be endured. Why? You speak like a most ancient and quiet watchman, for I cannot see how sleeping should offend. Only have a care that your bills be not stolen. Well, you are to call at all the ale houses. And bid those that are drunk, get them to bed.
How if they will not?
Why, let them alone until they are sober. If they make you not then the better answer, why, you may say they are not the men you took them for.
Well, ma'am,
if you meet a thief, you may, by virtue of your office, suspect him to be no true man. And for such kind of men, the less you meddle or make with them, why, the more is for your honesty.
Well, if we know them to be thieves, shall we not lay hands on them?
Truly, by your office you may, but I think they that touch pitch will be defiled. The most peaceable way for you, if you do take a thief, is to let him show himself what he is and steal out of your company.
You have always been called a merciful one, partner.
Well, truly I would not hang a dog by my will, much more a man who hath any honesty in him.
If you hear a child cry in the night, you must call to the nurse and bid her still it.
Oh, how if the nurse be asleep and will not hear us?
Why then depart in peace and let the child wake her with crying. For the ewe that will not hear its lamb when it baws will never answer a calf when he pleats.
Tis very true.
This is the end of the charge. You, constable, are to present the prince's own person. If you meet the prince in the night, you may stay him.
Friar, our lady, I think I cannot.
Well, 5 shillings to one on it for any man that knows the statutes. She may stay him. Marry not without the prince be willing. For the watch ought to offend no man, and it is an offense to stay a man against his will.
Prior lady, I think it would be so.
Well, masters, good night. Should there be any matter of weight, chances, call up me. Keep your fellows' counsels and your own, and good night. Come, neighbor.
Well, officers, we hear our charge.
Let us
sit here until 2, and then to bed.
Thank you.
know the answer for that. Now forward with that tale.
Stand thee close, then, under this penthouse, for it drizzles rain. And I will, like a true drunkard, utter all to thee. Therefore, know I have earned of Dona Joan 1,000 ducats. Thou shouldst rather ask if it were possible any villain should be so rich. For when rich villains have need of poor ones may make what price they will.
Treason,
officers, yet close. Didst thou not hear somebody?
No. 'Twas the vane on the house.
Not so, neither. But know that tonight I have wooed Margaret, the waiting gentlewoman, to Hero. By the name of Hero, she leans me out her mistress' chamber window, bids me 1,000 times good night. I tell this tale vilely. I should first tell thee how the prince, Claudio, and my master, planted and placed and possessed by my master, Doña Joan, saw far off in the orchard this amiable encounter.
And don't they bargain with Hero?
2 of them did, the prince and Claudio. But the devil my master knew was Margaret, partly by her oaths which first possessed them, partly by the dark knights, which did deceive them, but chiefly by my villainy, which did confirm any slander Doña Joan had made away when Claudio, enraged, swore he would meet with her, as he was appointed the next morning there at the church, and for the full congregation, and shame her with what he saw her night, and send her home again without a husband.
In the prince's name, back!
Call up the right master constable. We have uncovered here the most dangerous piece of treachery that was ever known in the Commonwealth.
I know him! The deformed is one of them. She wears a lock.
Ladies, ladies.
Oh, you'll be made bring deformed forth, I warn you.
Ladies.
Never speak. We command you to let us obey you to go with us.
We like to take goodly commodity to these ladies' bills.
Commodity in question, I warn you.
Come, we will obey you.
A horse or a husband?
for the letter that begins them all.
Well, and you be not turned, there's no more sailing by the star.
What speaks the fool, Tro?
Nothing I. The gods send everyone their heart's desire. These gloves the Count sent me, they are an excellent perfume.
I am stuffed, cousin. I cannot smell.
I'm made and stuffed. There's goodly catching of cold.
God help me. God help me. How long have you professed apprehension?
Even since you left it. Doth not my wit become me rarely?
It is not seen enough. You should wear it on the fashion of your cap. I am sick.
Get you some of this distilled Carduus Benedictus, and lay it to your heart. It is the only thing for qualm.
There thou prickest her with a thistle. Benedictus? Why Benedictus? You have some moral in this Benedictus?
Moral? No, by my troth, I have no moral meaning. I meant plain holy thistle. You may think, perchance, that I think you are in love. Nay, by your lady, I am not such a fool as to think what I list, nor I list not to think what I can, nor indeed I cannot think, if I would think my heart out of thinking that you are in love, or that you will be in love, or that you can be in love. Yet Benedict was such another, and now is he become a man. He swore he would never marry, and yet now, in spite of his heart, he eats his meat without grudging. And how you may be converted, I know not. But methinks you look with your eyes as other women do.
What piece is this that I tell keeps?
Not a false gallop.
Madam, withdraw! The prince, the count, Signor Benedict, Doña Joan, and all the gallants of the town are come to fetch you to church.
Help me to dress, good cuz. Good night, good Ursula.
Would you with me, honest neighbor?
Marry, sir, we would have some confidence with you that discerns you nearly.
Yes, true. It is so. What is it, good friend?
Goodman Verges here speaks little off the matter. A young man, sir, and his wits are not so blunt as, God willing, I would they were. But, in faith, as honest as the skin between his brows.
I thank God I am as honest as any man living that is a young man and no honester than I.
Comparisons are odorous. Calabras, neighbor Burgess.
Neighbors, you are tedious.
It please your worship to say so, but we are the poor duke's officers. But truly, for mine own part, if I were as tedious as a king, I could find it in my heart to bestow it all of your worship.
All thy tediousness on me, huh?
Yea, it were 1,000 pounds more than 'tis, for I hear as good an exclamation on your worship as any man in the city, and though I be but a poor man, I am glad to hear it.
And so am I. I may know what you have to say.
Mary, sir, our watch tonight, accepting your worship's presence, had had a couple of errant knaves as any in Messina.
A good young man, sir, he will be talking. Well, as they say, when no wage is in, the wit is out. God help us, it's a world to see. Well said, faith, neighbor Burgess. Well, God's a good man. When two men must ride of a horse, one must ride behind. An honest soul, if faith, sir, by my troth he is as ever broke bread, but God is to be worshipped, not all men are alike. Alas, good neighbor.
Indeed. For he comes too short of you.
Gifts that God gives.
I must leave you.
One word, sir. Our watch, sir, have indeed comprehended two auspicious persons, and we would have them this morning examined before your worship.
Take their examination yourself and bring it me.
I'm in great haste, as it may appear unto you. It shall be suffragists. Drink some wine. There you go. Fare you well.
My lord, is they free to give your daughter to her husband?
I'll meet with them. I am ready.
Go, good partner, go! Get you to George's seat home. Bid her bring her pen and ink hole to the jail. We are now to exterminate these men.
And we must do so wisely.
Ah, we will spare for no wit, I warrant you. Only get the learned writer to set down our excommunication and meet me at the jail.
To her. Why have you come to marry her?
Lady, you come hither to be married to this count.
I do.
If either of you should know of any inward impediment, this is why you should not be joined. I charge you on your souls to literates.
Know you any hero?
None, my lord.
Know you any count?
I dare make his answer. None.
What men dare do? What men may do? What men daily do without knowing what they do?
How now? Interjections?
Stand thee by, friar. Father, do you, with unconstrained soul, give freely this maid your daughter?
As freely, son, as God did give her me.
And what have I to counterpoise this rich and precious gift?
Nothing, unless you render her again.
Sweet prince, you earn me noble thankfulness. There, Leonato, take her back again. Give not this rotten orange to your friend. She's but the sign and semblance of her honor. Behold how like a maid she blushes here. Comes not that blood as honest witness to simple virtue? Would you all that see her swear that she were a maid by these exterior shows? But she is none. She knows the heat of a luxurious bed. Her blush is guiltiness, not modesty.
My lord, what do you mean?
Not to be married, not to knit my soul to an approved wanton.
Dear Claudio, if you and your own proof have made vanquish the defeat of her virginity.
I know what you would say. You would say that if I had known her, that she would have embraced me as a husband, and thus extenuate the beforehand sin. No, Leonato, I never tempted her with word too large, but showed bashful sincerity and comely love.
And seemed I ever otherwise to you?
Out on thee, seeming. I will write against it.
Is my lord well that he doth speak so wide?
Sweet prince, why speak not you?
What should I speak? I stand as honored that have gone about to link my dear friend to a common stale.
Are these words spoken, or do I but dream?
Sir, they are spoken, and these things are true.
True? Oh, God!
What of it, Claudio?
Allow me to move but one question to your daughter.
Oh, God, defend me! How am I beset? What kind of catechizing call you this?
To make you answer truly to your name.
Is it not Hero? Who can blot that name with any just reproach?
Marry, that can Hero. Hero itself can blot out Hero's virtue. Now answer this. Who was the man you spoke with yesternight betwixt the hours of 12 and 1? If you are a maid, you will answer truly.
I talked with no man at that hour, my lord.
Why then are you no maiden? Leonato, I am sorry you must hear. Upon mine honor, myself, my sister, and this grieved count did see her. Hear her at that hour, talk with a ruffian at her chamber window, who hath indeed, almost like a liberal villain, confessed that the vile encounters they had had a thousand times in secret.
Fie, fie. They're not to be said, my lord, not to be spoken of. There's not chastity in language without the offense to utter them. Thus, pretty lady, I am sorry for thy much misgovernment.
What a hero hadst thou been, if half thy thoughts had been placed about thy heart. But fare thee well, most foul, most fair. Farewell, thou pure impiety and impious purity. For thee I'll lock up all the gates of love, and on my eyelid shall conjecture hang, to turn all beauty into thoughts of harm, and never shall it more be gracious.
What? Oh no, cousin hero, wherefore set you down?
Come, let us go. Things come thus to light, smother her spirits up.
How doth the lady?
Dead, I think. Help, uncle. Hero, how now, cousin hero?
Comfortably. Dost thou look up?
Eh? Wherefore should she not?
Wherefore? Why, dost not every earthly thing cry shame upon her?
Sir, be patient. For my part, I'm so tired of wonder. I don't know what to say.
Oh, on my soul, my cousin is belied.
Lady, were you bedfellow last night?
No, truly not, though. Until last night, I have this 12-month been her bedfellow.
Confirmed. Confirmed! That which was made stronger, which was before barred up with ribs of iron. Would the two princes lie? Would Claudio lie, who loved her so, that speaking of her foulness, washed it away with tears? Hence from her, let her die!
Hear me a little. My bowl has been silent so long and given way to this cursed fortune. By nothing of the lady, I'm worth 1,000 blushing apparitions to start from her face. 1,000 innocent chains and angel white to feed away those blushes. And in her eye had to put a fire to burn the errors that these princes hold against her made it true. Call me a fool, just not my rating nor my observations, which experience so doth warrant the tenor of my book. Just not my age, my reverence, calling her divinity. But this sweet lady lie not guiltless here of some biting error?
Friar, it cannot be. Thou seest that all the grace that she hath left is that she will not add to her damnation. A sin of perjury? She not denies it. Why seekest then now to cover with excuse that which appears in proper nakedness?
Lady, what man is he you are accused of?
They know that do accuse me. I know not. If I know more than any man alive than that which maiden modesty doth warrant, let all my sins lack mercy. Oh, my father, prove you that any man with me conversed in hours unmeet, or that I yesternight maintained the change of words with any creature. Refuse me, hate me, torture me to death.
You're so strange, Mr. Precision, the princess.
Two of them have the very bin of honor. And if their wisdom be misled in this, the practice of it lives in Doña Joan, whose spirits toils to frame a villainies. I know not.
Pause a while, and let my counsel sway you in this case. Your daughter here, the princess left dead. Let her a while be kept in and publish it that she is dead indeed. Retain a mode of ostentation, not in frames or monument, and your benefits have to do all rights that number to the two.
What will this do? What will become of this?
Mary, this one carries, shall, on her behalf, change slander for remorse. That is some good, and not for the dream on the strange course, but on the travail look for greater worth. She dying, as it must be so maintained upon the innocent that she was accused, and shall be pitied, lamented, and excused. If every hero so holds up, that what we have by much good worth lost in its hours, was being back and lost. By then, we rack about. Then we find the virtue that possession will not show us what serves ours. So will it fare with Claudio, when he shall hear that she died upon his words, the idea of her life shall sweetly creep into his study of imagination, and every lovely organ of her life shall come more apparelled with more precious habit, more moving, delicate, and full of life into the high prospect of his soul, and when she lived indeed. Then shall he mourn. Ever love had interest in his liver, which he had not so accused her, no. Only thought his accusations true. Let this be so. Not off a successful fashion of event to better shape than I can in the life of the if all aim, beloved, falls to supposition of the lady's death, and quench the wonder of the infant. And
if your soul thou wilt, may consider it the best bitch for a holy reputation. For some reclusive and religious life, of all eyes, minds, tongues, and injuries.
Signor Leonardo, let the fart advise you. Though you know my inwardness and love is very much onto the prince and Claudio, yet, by my honor, I'll deal this as secretly and justly as your soul, shared with your body.
Being that I flow in grief, the smallest twine may lead me.
I will not desire that.
You have no reason. I do it freely.
Surely, I do believe your fair cousin is wrong.
What might the man deserve of me that would right her?
Is there any way to show such friendship?
A very evil way, and no such friend.
May a man do it?
It's a man's office, but not yours.
I do love nothing in the world so well as you. It's not that strange.
The strange thing I know not. It were as possible for me to say I love nothing so well as you. But believe me not, yet I lie not. I confess nothing nor deny that nothing. I am sorry for my cousin.
And my sword, it's just thou lovest me.
Do not swear by it, any.
I'll swear by that you love me, and I'll make you mean it says that not, I love not you.
You not each other.
No source that you devise to it. I confess, I love thee.
Then God forgive me. You have saved me in a happy hour. I was about to protest that I loved you.
And do it with all thy heart.
I love you with so much of my heart, there is none left to protest.
Come, bid me do anything for thee.
Kill Claudio.
Not in the wide world.
Kill me to deny. Farewell.
Teresa, Beatrice.
I am gone though I am here, nay, there is no love in you. I pray you let me go.
Beatrice.
In faith, I will go.
We'll be friends first.
Dare easier be friends with me than fight with mine enemy.
Is Claudio thine enemy?
Is he not approved in the height of villain? That it slandered, dishonored, scorned my kinswoman? God, that I were a man. What? Bear her in hand until they come to take hands, and then with public accusation, unmitigated slander, uncovered rancor. Oh, God, that I were a man, I would eat his heart in the marketplace.
Hear me.
What?
Here.
Talk with a man out of window? A proper saying. Sweet hero, she is wronged, she is slandered, she is undone. Princes and counties, a princely testimony, a surely count. Count confect, a sweet gallant, surely. God, that I were a man, that I had any man would be a friend for my sake. But manhood is melted into courtesies, and valor into compliment, and men are only turned into tongue, and trim ones too. He is now as valiant as Hercules, that only tells a lie and swears by it. I cannot be a man with wishing, therefore I will die a woman with grieving.
Tarry me, by this man who loved me.
Use it for my love some other way than by swearing by it.
Think in your soul that the Count Claudio hath wronged Hero?
Yea, as sure as I have a thought for a soul.
Enough! I am engaged. I will challenge him and I'll kiss your hand. By this hand, Claudio shall render me a dear account. As you hear of me, so think of me. Go, comfort your cousin. I must say she is dead. So, farewell. that certain. We have the exhibition to examine.
But which the old men are to be examined? Let them come before Master Constable.
Yea, Mary, let them come before me. What is your name, friend?
Borachio.
Pray, write down Borachio. Yours, Sirrah?
I'm a gentleman, ma'am, and my name is Conrad.
Pray write down Master Gentleman Conrad. Masters, do you serve God?
Yea, ma'am.
We hope.
Write down they hope they serve God, but write God first. For God defend, but God should go before such villains. Masters, it is proved already that you are a little better than false knaves and will go near to be thought so shortly. How answer you for yourselves?
Mary, ma'am, we say we are not.
A marvelous witty fellow, I assure you, but hey, we'll go about with him. Come you hither, sirrah, a word in your ear. Sir, I say to you, it is thought you are false knaves.
Sir, I say to you, we are none.
Now, stand aside, for God, they are both in a tale. Have you writ down they are none?
Master Constable, you go not the way to examine. You must call forth the watch, as their accusers.
Yea, Mary, that is the eftest way. Let the watch come forth. Masters, I charge you in the prince's name. Accuse these men.
This man said that Donya Joan, the prince's sister, was a villain.
Write down Donya Joan, a villain. Why, this is flat perjury to call a prince's sister villain.
Master Constable!
Pray thee, fellow, peace! I do not like thy look. I promise.
A thousand ducats of Donya Joan for accusing the lady Hero wrongfully.
What burglary as ever was committed.
And that Count Claudio did mean upon his word that he would disgrace Hero before the whole assembly and not marry her.
Oh, villain! Thou wilt be condemned into everlasting redemption for this!
What else? This is all.
And this is more, everyone, than you can deny. Donna Joan is this morning certainly stolen away. Hero was in this manner accused of his very man, rebuked, and upon weakness, suddenly died. Master Constable, let these men be bound and brought to the lady. I will go and will show them their examination.
Let them be opinion.
Let them be in the
house. Ah, coxcomb!
God's my life, where's the sexton? Pray, let him write Prince's officer coxcomb. Go bind them, thou naughty varlet.
Away! You're an ass! You are an ass!
Dost thou not suspect my years?
Oh.
That you were here to write me down an ass! Oh, but masters, remember that I am an ass! Though it be not written down yet, forget not that I am an ass! No, thou villain, thou art full of piety as shall be proved upon thee by good witness. I am a wise fellow, and, which is more, an officer, and, which is more, a householder, and, which is more, as pretty a piece of flesh as any is in Messina, and one that knows the law, go to, and a rich fellow enough, go to, and one that hath two gowns and everything handsome about her, bring him away, oh, that I had been writ down an ass!
Thank you.
pray thee, cease thy counsel, which falls into mine ears as profitless as water into a sieve.
If you go on thus, you will kill yourself, and 'tis not wisdom thus to harm yourself.
No, give me no counsel, nor let no comforter delight mine ears, but such a one whose wrongs do suit with mine. Bring me a father who so loved his child, whose joy of hers overwhelmed as mine. If such a one does smile, stroke his beard, bid sorrow wag, cry, when he should grow, patch grief with proverbs, and bring him yet to me, and I of him will gather patience. But sister, there is no such man, 'cause men can counsel and speak comfort to that grief which they themselves do not feel. No, no, give me no counsel. My griefs cry louder than advertisement.
Therein do men from children nothing differ.
I pray thee, I will be made flesh and blood. There is never a philosopher that could endure the toothache patiently.
Yet bend not all the harm upon yourself. Make those that do offend you suffer too.
There, thou speakest reason. Nay, I will do so. My soul doth tell me that heroes belied. So shall Claudio know, so shall the prince, and all those that dishonor her.
Here come the prince and Claudio.
Good day. Good morrow to the both of you.
Hear you, my lords?
We have some haste, Nato.
Some haste, my lords. Well, fare thee well. Are you so hasty now? Well, all is won.
Nay, do not quarrel with us, good old man.
If he could fight himself quarreling, some of us would lie low.
Who wrongs him?
Thou dost wrong me. Thou hast belied mine innocent child. Thy slander has gone through and through her heart. And there she lies buried with her ancestors, all in a tomb where never scandal slept, save this of hers, framed by thy villainy.
My villainy?
Thine, Claudio, thine, I say.
Speak not right.
I'll prove it on his body, if he dare.
Away, I will not have to do with you.
No? Canst thou so daft me? Thou hast killed my child. If thou killest me, boy, thou shalt kill a man.
He shall kill two of us, and men, indeed, but 'tis no matter. Let him kill one first. Win me, and where me? Let him answer me. Come, follow me, boy. Come, sir boy, come, follow me, sir boy. I will whip you from your foining fence. Nay, as I am a gentlewoman, I will.
Sister.
Content yourself. God knows I loved my niece, and she is dead. Slander to death by villains that dare as well answer a man indeed as I dare take a serpent by the tongue. Boys, apes, braggarts, jacks, milksops!
Sister Antonia.
I know them, yea, and what they weigh, even to the utmost. Scrambling, outfacing, fashion-monging boys that lie and cog and flout, deprave and slander, go antically show outward hideousness and throw off half a dozen dangerous words how they might hurt their enemies if they durst. And this is all.
But sister, and
come, do not meddle. Let me deal in this.
My heart is sorry for the death of your daughter, but upon my honor, was tried with nothing but what was very true and full of proof.
My lord.
I will not hear you.
No. Come, sister, away. I will be heard.
And shall, for some of us will smart for it.
Now here comes the man you went to seek.
Good day, my lord.
I came to seek you both. As I am an honest man, you look pale. Art thou sick or angry?
Courage, man. What care thou hast in thee, thou hast courage to kill care itself.
Shall I speak a word in your ear?
God bless me with the challenge.
You are a villain. I jest not. I'll make it good. How you dare, with what you dare, and when you dare. Do me right, or I'll test your cowardice. You have killed a sweet young lady, and her death shall fall heavy on you.
My good lord, for your many courtesies, I thank you, but I must depart from your company. Your sister has blessed on us here. You, a monk, have killed a sweet and innocent lady. For Lord Lackbeard there, he and I shall meet. Until then, peace be with you.
Is in earnest. No doubt for the love of Beatrice.
And hath challenged me.
Most sincerely.
Did he not say my sister was fled?
Come you, sir. If justice cannot tame you, she shall ne'er weigh more reasons in her balance. Nay, and you being a cursing hypocrite once, you must be looked to.
How now? Two of my sisters stand now. Gracia, what?
Relay them their charges, my lord.
Officers, what have these men done?
Mary, sir, they have committed false report. Moreover, they have spoken untruths. Secondarily, they are slanders. Sixth, and lastly, they have belied a lady. Thirdly, they have verified unjust things. And, to conclude, they are lying knaves.
First, I ask thee what they had done. Thirdly, I ask what is their offense. Sixth, and lastly, why they are committed. And to conclude, what you lay to their charge.
Gentlemen, this learned constable is much too wise to be understood. Be there another man to come forward to speak for him?
Who have you offended, master, since you are thus bound to your answer? This third is too cunning to be understood. What is your offense?
Sweet prince, let me go no farther to mine answer. Do you hear me? And let this count kill me, for I have deceived even your very eyes, which your wisdoms could not discover. These shallow fools brought to light when the knight overheard me confessing to this man, how Dona Joan, your sister, set me to slander the Lady Hero. The villainy they have upon record, which I'd rather seal with my death than repeat over to my shame. The lady is dead upon mine and my master's false accusations, and briefly I desire nothing but the reward of a villain.
Runs not this speech like iron through your blood?
I have drunk a poison whilst he uttered it. Did my sister set thee on this?
Yea, paid me richly for it.
She is composed and framed a treachery, and she has fled upon this villainy.
Oh, hero, now thy image doth appear in the very semblance that I loved at first.
Bring away the plaintiffs. By this time our sexton have reformed the Signor Leonato of the matter. And masters, when time and place shall specify, forget not that I am an ass.
Hear, hear. Signor Leonato and the sexton, too. Which is the villain?
Let me see his eyes. Art thou the slave that with thy breath hast killed my innocent child?
Yea, even I alone.
No, not so. Thou liest thyself. There stands a pair of honorable men. A third had a hand in it, who has fled. I thank thee, princess, for my daughter's death. Hang it with your high and worthy deeds. 'Twas bravely done, if you bethink you of it.
I know not how to ask your forgiveness, but I accept any charge and punishment willingly.
By my soul, nor I, and yet to satisfy this good old man, would bend under any heavy weight that you enjoy.
Cannot bid you bid my daughter live. That were impossible. But I pray you, possess the people here in Messina, how innocent she died. And if your love can labor aught in sad invention, hang her an epitaph upon her tomb. Sing it to her bones. Sing it tonight. Tomorrow you come to my house. Since you could not be my son-in-law, be yet my nephew. My sister has a daughter. Give her the same right you should have given her cousin, and so dies my revenge.
Oh, noble sir, I know not how to give you
thankfulness. I accept this, and this follows henceforth from this poor Claudio.
I will expect you tomorrow.
You will not fail.
We will speak with Margaret and this blue fellow.
No! By my soul, she was not. Nor do you know what she did when she spoke to me. But always hath been just and virtuous, anything that I do know by her.
Moreover, sir, this plaintiff here, the offender, did call me an ass. I beseech you, let it be remembered in his punishment. Also, the watch heard them talk of one deformed. They say he wears a key in his ear and a lock hanging by it, and borrows money in God's name, the which he hath used so long and never paid, that now men grow hard-hearted and will lend nothing in God's sake. I pray you, examine him upon that point.
I thank thee for thy care and honest thanks.
You speak like a most thankful and reverend youth, and I praise God for thee.
I thank thee for thy pains.
God save the foundation!
Farewell, my lords. Until tomorrow.
Well, my lords, we will look for thee tomorrow.
I leave an errant knave with your worship, which I beseech your worship to correct yourself for the example of others. God keep your worship. God restore you to health. I humbly give you my leave to depart, and if a merry meeting may be wished, God prohibit it. Come, neighbor.
To death by slanderous tongues is the hero that here lies. Death and guerdon of her wrongs gives her flame which never dies. And so the life that died in shame lives on in death with glorious fame. Now, unto thy bones, good night. Yearly will I do this rite.
Pray thee,
sweet Mistress Margaret,
deserve all at my hands by helping me to the speech of Beatrice.
Will you then write me a sonnet in praise of my beauty?
It's so high a style, Margaret, that no man living shall come over it. In most comely truth, thou deservest it.
To have no man come over me? Why, shall I always keep a low stare?
Thy wit is as quick as the greyhound's mouth. Catch.
And yours is blunt as the fencer's foils, which hit, but hurt not.
A most manly wit, Margaret. It would not hurt a woman. And now, I pray thee, call Beatrice. I give thee the bucklers.
Give us the sword. We have bucklers of our own.
You use them, Margaret. You must put in the pikes with the bucks.
And they are dangerous weapons.
Well, I will call Lady Beatrice to you, who I think hath legs.
Every good thing.
The God of Love that sits above. Knows me, how pitiful. I mean, it's singing, but in loving.
Leander, the good swimmer.
Troilus, the first employer of panders. And a whole book full of these quantum carpet mangers
whose names yet run smoothly in the even road of a blank verse.
Why, I've never so truly turned over and over as my poor self in love. Mary, I'm not short at rhyme. I've tried. I can't find no rhyme to school, but fool in innocent rhyme. For scorn, or a hard rhyme. For lady, baby, a babbling rhyme. No, I cannot woo in festival terms. No, I was not born under a rhyming planet. Wouldst thou come when I call for thee?
Yea, and depart when you bid me.
Oh, stay but till then.
Then is spoken. Fare you well now, and yet, ere I go with what I came, which is knowing what hath passed between you and Claudio.
Only foul words. Thereupon, I will kiss thee.
Foul words is but foul wind, and foul wind is but foul breath. And foul breath is noisome. Therefore, I will depart unkissed.
Thou hast mined the words out of his right sense. So forcibly is thy wit. But I must tell thee plainly that Claudio undergoes my challenge. And either I must shortly hear from him, or I will subscribe him a coward. And now tell me, how doth it go?
Very ill.
How do you?
Very ill.
Serve God. Love me. There I'll leave you two, for here comes one in haste.
Madam, you must come to your uncle. Yonder's old coil at home. It is proof my lady Hero hath been falsely accused. The prince and Claudio mightily abuse, and Doña Joan is the author of all. Who is but in gone? Will you come? Presently?
I will live in thy heart, die in thy lap, and be buried by thy eyes. And I, moreover, I'll go with you to hear this news.
And Claudio, who accused her in the error that you heard debated. But Margaret was in some fault for this, although against her will, as it may appear in the true course of all the question.
Oh, I'm glad that all things sort so well.
Daughter, good gentlewomen all, retreat into a chamber, and when I call for you, come hither veiled. The prince and Claudio had promised by this hour to visit me. Sister, you know your office. You must be parent to your brother's daughter, and give her to young Claudio.
Which I will do with you first, confidence.
Friar, I must entreat your pain.
You must, Signor.
To bind me, or undo me, one of them. Signor Leonardo, truth it is, good Signor, your niece regards me with an eye of faith.
An eye that my daughter lent her.
And I do with an eye of love requite.
One which I think that you got from me, from the prince, and from Claudio, but what is your will?
Your answer, sir, is enigmatical. But for my will is your good will. May stand with ours this day to be conjoined in the state of honorable marriage, in which, good friar, I shall desire your help.
My heart is with your liking.
My help. Ah, here comes Prince Claudio.
Tomorrow to this fair assembly.
Good morrow, Prince. Claudio, we here attend you. Are you yet determined to marry my sister's daughter?
Aye, my lord. Tomorrow, Benedict.
Good morrow.
Which is the lady I must seize upon?
The same as she.
Sweet. Let me see your face.
No, not until you take her hand before this friar and promise to marry her.
give me your hand. Before this holy friar, I am your husband, if you like with me.
And when I lived, I was your other wife. And when you loved, you were my other husband.
Another hero.
Nothing certainer. One hero died defiled, but I do live.
Former hero, hero that is dead.
I died, my lord, but whilst my slander lived.
All this amazes me. Can I qualify? When after the holy rites are ended. Until you largely fair hero's death. Meanwhile, with honors to familiar, to the chapel, let us present.
Something fair, friar! Which is Beatrice?
I answer to that name. What is your will?
Do not you love me?
No more than reason.
Well, then your uncle and the prince and Claudia have been deceived. They swore you did it.
Do not you love me?
Truth, no more than reason.
Why then my cousin Margaret and Ursula are much deceived, for they did swear that you did.
They swore you were sick for me.
They swore you well nigh dead for me.
Tis no such matter.
You do not love me?
No, truly, but in friendly recompense.
Come, niece, I am sure you love the gentleman.
And I'll be sworn upon it that he loves her. For here, writ in his own hand, a halting sonnet of his own pure brain, fashioned to Beatrice.
And here's another note, written my cousin's hand, stolen from her pocket, containing her affection, unprepared.
A miracle. Here our own hands against our hearts. Come, I'll have thee. But by this light, I take thee for pity.
I would not deny you, but by this good day, I yield upon great persuasion, and hearts will save your life, for I was told you were in a great consumption.
Peace. I'll stop your mouth.
Thank you.